Quick show of hands, just I'm curious. Has anyone here in the audience contributed to Astro before? Okay, we got some plants, they don't count. Anyone contributed to open source at all? Any project whatsoever? A bug fix, a PR? Yes, there you go. Give it up for you all as well. Just amazing. Open source software is powered by contributions like that, so it's just incredible that you all are doing that and keeping these projects alive. So thank you. Thank you. All right, let's get to the final talk, the future of Astro. You know, earlier Matthew shared a couple of the design principles that he loves, and one of my favorite ones is actually from the earliest days of this project, this idea of pushing the web forward, that Astro isn't just another framework, but we're actually pushing the web forward. We're challenging best practices and norms and the ways that people think websites should be built. To go back to this chart, this idea that Astro's performance improvements, they aren't just a thing that happened. They're something that we really tried hard to get to, that we really worked hard to think about what is a website and how should one be built and how could you architect one for better performance. So this is no accident to see this up here. Island architecture was the name of the big innovation that we kind of came up with in 2021. This idea of a first-of-its-kind architecture built around partial hydration. So instead of shipping a JavaScript application, SPA, powerful but not very performant, Astro kind of flipped that architecture and instead focused on shipping server-rendered HTML, stripping away all the JavaScript, but then leaving you with these islands of interactivity. In 2022, we did it again with content collection. So this idea of, what if there was a first-party primitive inside of Astro for working with content? Your Markdown, your MDX, type-safe, validated, schema-defined, first-party content for the framework that's built for content. Easy. And then last, but not least, by a long shot, we partnered with the Google Chrome team to build the first-ever API built around view transitions. The idea of browser-native app-like transitions without a bunch of JavaScript, without a bunch of coding. First party in Astro to make your website feel like an app. Now, it's a new year, what should we work on? Well, excited to announce, we're entering the metaverse, baby. No, I'm just kidding. But I do want to present our vision for the future of Astro. And really, when I think about this, I think about the future of all content-focused websites. How can we push the web forward? And the way I want to do that is by showing off three innovations that we're going to be working on this year, building on those same exact three things I just shared off, these foundational pieces of Astro. We want to push each of these forward this year. And so I'm going to show off some cool stuff around islands, content collections, and view transitions. Now, a lot of this is early. It's still exploration. But I'm really excited to show this off because I think it's a good hint at where we're headed, along with a couple of demos as well. So let's start with view transitions. Y'all might know this demo. It was making the rounds on Twitter a while ago. You might think this is Spotify. You might think it's a big, heavy application, Electron, JavaScript, SPA. In reality, this is a clone of Spotify built with Astro using almost no JavaScript. This is powered by browser animations using the new View Transition API. So native browser support, not a bunch of JavaScript, powered by the browser, which means we don't have to do so much work. You don't have to do so much work. All those animations, not a single line of JavaScript written by the developer, not even a single line of CSS. We give you these directives to wipe and fade and morph. You annotate your HTML with them, and you get those animations automatically. Again, not a heavy lift for your code or for the browser. And we built these in a way that would be future-proof. So could we build APIs that would grow into the future as the spec evolved, as more features were announced? But there's also backwards compatible, because a future spec, you know, browsers, they move slow, they're powerful, but it's you know, it takes years for some of these things to come along. And so this idea of backwards compatibility built into the framework, best practices built in the framework, and built it in a way that would be future-proof for the future of all these features and how the browsers would continue to evolve, minimizing the changes that you would need. Now, to do that, to hit that kind of perfect balance, we had to get a little creative. We ended up injecting a SPA router into your site to get that backwards compatibility, which, if you know anything about Astro, that's like the last thing we would ever do. Our whole thing is about not injecting routers, not taking over from the browser, and here we are literally taking over for the browser, saying we can do it better, when in fact, it's anything but. It's really difficult to do this well. So why would we do this, right? Why would we ever dip our toes in this evil, dark pool of routing? Ugh. The reason was that we wanted to take a bet on where browsers were going, And I bet that one day, in the far future, the browser would ship the full spec, keep iterating, and get to a place where you'd already have the APIs and the code in place. You could remove this polyfill, this backwards compatible polyfill, and your entire site would continue to work now browser native, no JavaScript. This was our bet that one day in the future, that would happen. I'm excited to announce that that day is today, because zero JavaScript view transitions are here in Chrome, they're coming in Edge, and you can use them in Astro with zero changes. One quick line of change, that's all you need to use in Astro. Zero JavaScript. Super, super cool. Native browser stuff. You know, I could talk about it more, but I really want to show you what we're talking about, because it is so cool to see how simple this is and how powerful it is over here on the demo. Now, let's pull this up. There we go. Beautiful. If you've ever used our view transition support, you'll notice this component here. This is how you enable our backwards compatibility with older browsers. And if I go over here, hopefully this is the right one. Yes. You can see this demo actually running, the exact same one I showed. I just cloned it and tried it out. You can see these navigations happening. They feel native. They feel like an app. And you'll see here in the network panel, you'll see us taking over that routing, right? This is not really refreshing the page. It's all one page, all one experience, and we're fetching these pages using our router. Now, what the browsers are shipping is this idea of actually full page navigation. So you literally click a link, you'd be used to a full page wipe, a full page rebuild. But what the browser is doing is actually navigating the before and the after and then morphing it for you. So it acts like a full page, but in reality, it's all looking like an app. So let's show you how easy this is to do. You have your view transitions. We're going to wipe that. Let's quickly go back and see what happened. Everything's gone. What happened? Where'd it go? It's gone. Now, the browsers aren't just going to make every app transform. That would be crazy. So instead, there's a way to opt in, which is using CSS. It's a style tag. I'm just going to write that out. And an at rule. So we have at view transition. This is the new rule. And we're going to give this something which is animation. No, what is it? Oh my god, I'm blanking on this. Navigation equals auto. This is a native, look at that. Native API, native CSS rule that the browsers are going to understand. And if it doesn't understand it, you're going to notice it right away. Let's see. All right, I'm going to click this. Look at that. Nothing in the network panel. I can move around this thing beautifully. This is the browser morphing these elements along the page. Nothing is being fetched. Every time you're hitting a new one, here, I can go, I'll show you. Look at that. You're gonna see this network panel go crazy because it's actually hitting a new page. Things are cached, it's loading quickly, and the browser is diffing between the two. This is one of the coolest things, I think, to come out of Chrome and out of the spec process in a long time. Now, depending on when you're watching this, early June for Chrome, the next week for Edge, more browsers coming soon. You saw how easy that was to turn off and then turn on. It's a one-line change, so your app code remains exactly the same, and you can migrate on your own time. So if you're happy and you want to wait for the browsers to settle a bit, that's fine. If you want the bleeding edge, that's also fine. This is something that you can adopt whenever you're ready, and it's a one-line change. So that's view transitions. Let's talk about content quickly, because this is one of my favorite things about Astro, this content story. If you've ever used content collections, a bit of this was previewed earlier. It's a really simple API for grabbing full collections, single entries. It's all type safe. You start typing this out, you're going to get those autocompletes. It's really powerful for managing your markdown. Type safe, schema validated. You miss a front matter property, don't worry, we got you. It's all there. And your content lives in the directory. So you can see that source content directory. You've got your blog content, your markdown, maybe some JSON, data files. You manage it all in your repo, and you get that beautiful experience of just really quickly querying and loading what you need. Now, as we've grown, we're seeing a lot of people really push the limits of this, and a couple of key use cases keep coming up. People have content that lives all over the place. So maybe it doesn't live in a nice way that you can just migrate it into this code base. Maybe you have a different folder structure. Maybe you have internationalization that you need to worry about managing full copies of different versions and variants. Or maybe you have remote data. Part of the trade-off and part of the great developer experience is this enforced folder structure, which means you don't have a lot of flexibility. And so that's why I'm excited to announce that one of the things that we're working on this year is a Content Collections 2.0, something that lets you load your data from anywhere. So your local MDX, instead of giving you that enforced content structure, you can put it wherever you want. Put it in a content folder, put it in a different folder somewhere else entirely. It's totally up to you. We'll still do all that great globbing, validation, type safety, everything you've come to expect, but now the full flexibility to move that wherever you want. Maybe you have a big file that's full of a million different lines of data. You don't want to break that up into individual files. I totally get it. You could put a single file, and we'll still break that apart for you. You could load this from a remote data source. This could live entirely off of your code base. This could live on Storyblock, a great CMS, or anywhere, really, an API. Not only would this be something you could fetch from, but we can make it pluggable. We can put these into packages and integrations, so you can fetch data from anywhere around the internet into your project. And if all that is still not enough, you can just code it all yourself. We don't even care. Build whatever you want. This is totally free for you to build on top of to your heart's content. So this is a really big deal for us because we're breaking out of the local content store. We're breaking out of the you must follow these rules. We're letting you, the developer, figure out where you want to pull your data from, and we're still going to give you that great experience. Cached inside your content layer, you can fetch, rebuild. Every time you change a file, it's already there in the content layer. There's plenty more to show around how we might query, how we might scale this up to millions of content entries. Again, Glauber, you're getting all the shout-outs, but from the Terso team, SQLite has been brought up a couple times. How could we actually power this with something that could scale into millions of content posts? There's some really cool stuff. This is still stage one. There's an RFC available for you to check out. We're exploring this year, and I can't wait to see what you all build as we start to ship these APIs. So that's content collections. The last thing I have to show is something very, very special for island architecture. This is the idea of client islands, right? This is stuff we've been doing since day one. This is stripping away the JavaScript and shipping static HTML that's fast and performant, but still giving you these islands of interactivity, these components of UI that are interactive on the client, hydrated individually, so you're not paying the full weight of the page, just where you need it. This has been incredibly, incredibly popular for content sites because it's performant, helps you with your SEO, your conversion rates. But it's a bit of an interesting kind of trade-off, right? You basically have this pick. What if I want static HTML? It's fast and easy, but it's static, right? You can't really do much of it personalized. It's static. And maybe you have your client components interactive, but now you're shipping JavaScript to the client for whatever that interactivity is. So there's these two really powerful primitives, but they're kind of on opposite sides of the spectrum, right? What if you want that dynamic content, but you don't really want to ship a bunch of JavaScript to get it? So that's why I'm excited to announce server islands are being explored. The idea of shipping server-generated content to the page, but keeping the whole thing statically cached, statically built, globally cached on a CDN, you're getting this app shell, and it's really easy to use. This is just all you need to do to take something like a user button, which you might be familiar with as that little avatar in the top right on Google. That's personalized, right? That's your content. That's your face showing up. You add that server defer, and you'll be able to pull in that remote personalized data without forcing your entire page to be server rendered. So you still get a static site, and then dynamically that page is going to go and pull that data after the page is already loaded on your screen and fetch that personalized content. So you get static pages, present the shell, globally cached, works everywhere, works on any CDN. This is not proprietary. This can run anywhere. And if you have that personalized UI, that expensive thing, your culminating reviews or star votes, whatever it is on your site that you're trying to display, it can work performantly without shipping JavaScript to the client. So again, stage one, this is an early RFC that we're exploring alongside our community, but it represents one of the biggest shifts in our architecture since the early V1 days. If you've been following the React community, they've been going for almost a decade now working about suspense, streaming, and partial pre-rendering. These are really cool technologies, and we've been learning a lot from them, but we're really excited to present what we think this future architecture could look like. This is running on any CDN. It's making trade-offs for you that really work for content sites. So again, we're optimizing for the use case that we love, which is content sites that run anywhere. Now again, let me show this off because this is really cool to see in action. I'm going to take that exact same demo you saw with Spotify, and you saw I mentioned that we have that one component that's on the client. This one little good night is doing a lot of heavy lifting. This is actually a Svelte component. We've shipped all of Svelte just to run this one little UI. It's cool, but we don't really need to be interactive. It's just saying goodnight, putting us to bed. We don't need that to be interactive. We just want the content to be dynamic. We don't want to cache that. It's saying goodnight. You wake up tomorrow morning. It still says goodnight. So what would this look like? Well, we already played around with this. We're going to also go down and find that component, which is on your page. And it's this greeting title. That's what's powering the goodnight message. And I forgot to undo. This is what it did look like, client visible. So this is actually telling Astro to go and ship this as an island, load on visibility, and then become interactive as soon as possible. We're gonna delete this. We don't want it to be interactive. We want it to be dynamic, but we don't want it to be a server, or sorry, a client island. We don't want Svelte to have to ship just for that. And instead, we're going to do a little bit of magic here and hit server defer. This is telling Astro, hey, put something here that's a placeholder that you can define, and then we're gonna actually go, and after the page loads, fetch this dynamically. So it's not gonna block the page. If it's a static site, you can still ship it statically behind a CDN. But if you go here, we're gonna see this load, and without giving away, zero JavaScript on the client. Now I've added a fake delay here, so just to mimic something that takes a little while, something more expensive, it's not gonna add seconds to your page load. It's just gonna take this little component, give it a little delay, and it's gonna fade in naturally, okay? If all goes well, this will work. Drum roll, please, refresh. Nothing there, fake delay, loads in. And no JavaScript, look at that. Not a single JavaScript file. Dynamic content without a lot of JavaScript. There's a little inline script that we've injected onto the HTML page to do this, but we're talking, you know, very little code, and it's inline, so it's not a separate file. This is zero JavaScript requests in your network console. You can do this all day. Look, boop, fade in, very cool. Let me show one more example to show what we're talking about here. You've got here some personalized content. This is a fake blog post I grabbed from Tailwind, shout out to Tailwind. And my beautiful face in the top right. Now, again, personalized content, really hard to do, can't do it with a static site, can't do it with a CDN. In a traditional server environment, this is going to force that entire thing through a data center. So if you're coming in from internationally, that request is going all the way to that root data center to get that dynamic server rendering just for that little face, barely anything. And again, you could have used a client component, but again, you're building a client component. You're shipping JavaScript. You're building an API for it to talk about, for it to talk to. This is all the kind of current trade-offs in this new system. If we refresh this page, same fake delay, loads right in. Personalized content, statically cached. You can see no tricks here. This is running on Vercel. This is loading with zero JavaScript on the client, fetching that and hydrating it after the fact. Personalized content, static page. It's beautiful. It's a thing of beauty. I'm really excited for us to keep exploring this because it represents this full shift away. And if we could go back to the slides, some really powerful technology. Again, we care about content sites, so Core Web Vitals is core for this technology. If you compare this to anything else right now that exists, this is gonna give you really fast, largest contentful paint, one of the three Core Web Vitals. So by statically caching your page, you're getting the majority of it to the user as quickly as possible. This is gonna take that deferred item, that little UI, and that's not gonna impact your Core Web Vitals. That's actually, the web prefers it, user prefers it if that streams in after. So you're giving a faster Core Web Vital experience, optimizing for what we define as a performance site, and you're getting that global distribution. So if you're across the world, that thing's gonna load much faster than if it's running in a data center that you need to talk to. So super fast performance, built for Core Web Vitals, works with any infra, whatever host, wherever you wanna host this, it can run anywhere. And the best of all, it builds on existing primitives. So islands, right? This is not a new thing. Thinking of your page as a collection composed components. This is building on those same concepts that we've already been shipping for 3 years now. So it totally aligned with where we've been going and represents a huge, huge step forward for the concept of island architecture. So this is the future of Astro. This is the stuff that we are going to be working on this year that I'm so excited about. Zero JavaScript view transitions. It's kind of a trick. It's already here. It's coming, you know, that one's an easy. Check that box. Content collections and server islands. These are things we're going to be working on and building into Astro as we explore the future of Astro. So thank you all for hearing this. It's really exciting to be building on this and working with you all, and thank you so much for listening. Thank you.